Amen. We welcome you to church today on this Palm Sunday, Passion Sunday morning. So let's spend a few moments going over our announcements. We'd like to welcome everyone, whether you're in person or watching on one of our online platforms. So if you have not picked up a palm and would like one, there's some. We left them outside beginning yesterday, so if anyone is watching online, they could come by and pick them up. So they're inside, outside. Alice and some of the ladies made them into crosses, so whether you want them as a cross or just a long one or both, but please, we have plenty, so pick one up outside or inside. So let's go ahead and look at our announcements. We don't really have to tell you to wear a mask. Everybody's doing good for that. Hopefully, we'll get to the point we won't need to. So Tuesday, Alice's Bible study is happening along the way at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary. And then this Thursday is Monday-Thursday observation. So what I'm doing is something a little bit different. In the past years, we had services. And so it's more going to be a time of open communion similar to Ash Wednesday from 4 to 6 p.m. I also have a message. It's about 20 minutes long. We'll be sending out, the normal virtual ways that you can watch it ahead if you want to come in and, watch it in the church or in your car before you come in for communion. But just to give you a little hint, I'm going to be talking about Leonardo da Vinci's The Last Supper. And it's kind of interesting painting and most appropriate because that's what we're celebrating or remembering on Maundy Thursday is the Last Supper and Jesus' washing of the disciples' feet. So I hope you take an opportunity to watch that at some point. I'll try to get it out, before Thursday so you can take a look at that. So I did the best I can. I'm not always comfortable in front of a camera, so... So let's see what else is going on. So that's going to be Maundy Thursday. Saturday, homeless lunch prep and homeless lunch delivery at 9:30 and 11. Please know if you're involved in that or want to be involved in that, they changed that. They used to make everything on Saturday and deliver on Sunday. Now they are making and delivering all on Saturday. So note that change. This week, we got palms, as I mentioned, are available outside, inside. Please take some. Kathy would like to change her hours to deal with Char's schooling, so they'll be Wednesday and Thursday from 12 to 3, but she won't be here this Thursday. But if you need to get in touch with you, they can email or call the church office, and she'll get back to you. So... wanted to lift that up. Next Sunday is Easter. We'll have a celebration. I believe that we're past the deadline for, did we order flowers yet? Okay, so we got all, so that's done. So flowers will be delivered next week and we'll have our Easter celebration here at 10 a.m. Also want to note there's a trustee meeting in the fellowship hall on Wednesday, April 7th at 6 p.m. That is going to be a change in the leadership of the trustees. As we talked about, Darlene is having some health difficulties, and she no longer wants to be chair of that position. So we're going to have some combination of pending the trustees' approval. They could always not vote to do this. I don't want to preempt anybody. But the plan is that Rich Scott and Russ Brown would serve as sort of like co-chairs, even though one of them will have to be vice chair because of the way the bylaws are set up. But they're both, I think, will do very, very well in that. Okay, that's all the announcements I have. I think that was plenty. Any other announcements today that you would like to share? Please bear with me. The other mic broke the lavalier, so I kind of have to use this handheld, and we have one ordered until I can get it in. So I'll do the best I can with this one. There was an announcement. I saw someone's hand go up somewhere. Were you distracted? Okay. Do you want to hold that to the prayer time? This is an announcement, so, yeah. Okay, any announcements go as far as announcements? Going once, going twice. I always thought I should just keep talking and talking forever to see how long, to put Bo to the test of how long he can keep strumming there. So
play guitar all day.
Okay, no more announcements. Let's worship God with our opening prayer and our call to worship, and then we'll get into the worship. Lamb of God, we worship you and we proclaim the power in your name. We thank you and we glorify you as we acknowledge your deity on this special day of Palm Sunday. Blessed is he who comes in the name of God. You are the Prince of Peace. We adore you. Your love has set us free. Let the gospel of your grace settle in our hearts as we look to you for all our needs. Amen. The way has been prepared.
For the crowds, it is the way of celebration.
For Jesus, it is the way of completion.
Amid shouts and waving palm branches, he comes into the holy city.
Open your hearts this day to receive the Savior. We open wide our hearts and spirits to receive Jesus the Christ.
Sing to the King who is coming to reign. Glory to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain. Life and salvation his empire shall bring. Joy to the nations when Jesus is King. Come, let us sing a song declaring we belong to Jesus. He is all we need. Lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus. Sing to the
as we continue together in worship. Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. Turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you, long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Thank you. face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Wash away, Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Because when we see you, we find strength to face the day, and in your presence, your fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come on your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Amen. As we come to the time of offering, you can present your tithes and offering. You can do it online or the church app. Actually, you can also do it through your own bank. We do accept online banking. It's not electronic transfer, but most banks will cut a check and mail it to us. Works very well. Of course, you can bring it in person and use the basket back by the tech booth or mail, or put it in the white mailbox outside. So collectively, we are receiving all of our tithes and offerings for this week, and we'll worship God with a doxology.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Almighty and ever gracious Father God, we come here this day to celebrate and to worship you, your Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray that you would be among us, Lord, that you would help us in service to your kingdom, that you would bless us with your presence. Lord, we give back to you, especially this week, this beginning of Holy Week, because of everything that you have done for us. You did not go to the cross for yourself, but you went to the cross and suffered and died for us, Lord. So, Lord, we are so appreciative of what you have done for us. We give back to you our life, our tithes and offerings, and everything, so that we may be in service to your kingdom. We lift this up in the strong name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is not only the Lamb of God, but also the great high priest. Amen. You may be seated as we continue in a time of prayer. We want to keep Alan Martin in our prayers. he had a blood clot in his brain, and he's not responsive. And so we want, if you want to add anything, Joel, when you can. Just want to note that his name is Alan, right? In the bulletin, it's Alan. So don't worry. For a long time, I always spelled Joellen's name like as a separate Joellen. She told me one time it's all one word. So, but on a more serious note, let's keep Alan in our prayers and Joellen and the family. He's not been responsive since his surgery. He's in the ICU at Allegheny General Hospital. So we'll keep that in very strong prayer. Also, we have Tom Hardington. He is a brother of Laurel Kaliza. Prayers are requested because he is having trouble breathing and walking, and the doctors are running tests at this time. This came out on the prayer chain earlier this week. And we'll open up for other prayers. I want to give Carol the first opportunity. She had her hand up first. So, Carol, what would you like to share? Okay, Greg Diakon, did you say he passed away? Okay, so we'll have prayers for his, he passed away from COVID. So we'll have prayers for that family and keep them in our prayers. Any others that need lifted up today, or joys, praises, whatever you'd like to share as far as prayers go?
I have one.
Yes, Cassie.
Courtney, who I've asked prayers for before, it was back in the hospital. She has kidney stones in her remaining kidney. She has pancreatitis, hypothyroidism, and PCOS. So prayers for her. She finally has a lot of diagnoses, but it's a long road ahead.
Her fiance is also recovering from
a
brain tumor surgery,
okay.
So she wanted to be home with him, and she's in the hospital.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's
okay.
a rough time for that couple, so prayers for them would be appreciated.
What's her husband's name?
Bo.
We'll keep prayers for Bo and Courtney, okay.
And if I could have one too, my grandfather had a heart attack on Friday, and so far he's doing well, but prayers for him and that he will rest.
Okay. Prayers for Bo's grandpa had a heart attack. Keep all that in our prayers. Yes. Liver cancer, the name again, Nancy? James Rowan, liver cancer. Thank you. We'll keep James in our prayer also. Alice, please. Prayers for the world. Well, that's kind of an always ongoing thing, isn't it? We'll keep everything in the world in our prayers. Yes. Any others today? Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and loving God, as we come before you, you heard a lot of situations that were lifted up here today. We lift up the young man, Greg, who passed away from COVID, and his family, Lord. We pray for Courtney and her husband, Bo, and the other Bo's grandfather had a heart attack. We pray for the Martin family. Lord, we pray for the world. We pray for many things that remain on our hearts and minds that were not specifically mentioned, Lord. We know that your Holy Spirit intercedes and hears those prayers too. Lord, we lift all of them collectively before you this day. And we know, Lord, sometimes we don't understand the way things go, and we wish they were maybe going in a different way. We know that you really do have the whole world in your hands, and we have to have the faith in you, Lord, that you know what you're doing, and you do. The world looked to you on this day when you went into the holy city of Jerusalem after a long journey, and most of the crowd thought you were going to do something entirely different than what you did, and couldn't believe, Lord, that you did not do it the world's way, but you did it your way. And a few days later, they were shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." So, Lord, Let us have trust in your ways. Let us have faith, even when we may not see it with our physical eyes, let us see things with eyes of faith. So we lift all of these things before you. And we know that when your disciples struggled with prayer, you gave them the model that we often say today as the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. I'm going to do something a little bit different today. Usually I read you the scripture, but today I'm going to talk about Luke chapter 19, some selective verses. First, I want to open this time of message with prayer, and then I want to give you some of the context and background of Luke 19. Let's pray together. Gracious God, I pray that as it comes to the time of message, Lord, that you would have the Holy Spirit help me to bring your word to your people. I know I cannot do it alone, and I need the Spirit's help, and I ask for the Spirit's help. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Often when we look at Scripture, especially a day like this, Palm Sunday, we read the story of Jesus coming into Jerusalem. It's a very familiar passage. The crowds are waving the palm branches, throwing their coats on the ground for him to walk on. They're welcoming him as a new kind of conquering hero who they think is going to drive the Romans out. So what I want to do today is give like a broader context in Luke chapter 19. So in that chapter of the Bible, you have four parts of it, or what we call four pericopes. The first one is Jesus comes, as I've been talking about during this Lenten season, he's coming from the north, from the Sea of Galilee, making his way towards Jerusalem. And when people traveled at that time in the Holy Land, they would travel the Jordan River Valley that connected the Sea of Galilee and the Dead Sea about 80 miles apart. And it was a very low area. In fact, the Dead Sea is still, it's the lowest point, the lowest elevation on the face of the earth. It is below sea level. Jericho is right near the Dead Sea. So it's a very low elevation. It's also the oldest city that still exists in the world. I mean, Jericho goes back thousands of years, and it's still a city today. So Jesus enters, and it's 3 miles away from Jerusalem, where Jesus will be crucified and resurrected. But guess what the direction is? It's pretty much straight up. If you're in the Jordan River Valley where Jericho is, Jerusalem is on Mount Zion, about 10,000 feet in elevation. So it's a long way up, and you're going back and forth in a very rocky area. Now, I like to always talk about the Bible and give you some background because I think it's important. You're familiar with the parable of the Good Samaritan. You know, the guy got robbed along the road from where? What was that road? It was the road from Jericho to Jerusalem. So there are lots of switchbacks for robbers to hide and that sort of thing. So Jesus arrives at the town or the city of Jericho, and he is amazingly popular. People, the crowds are swarming. And there's a little guy there who's a tax collector by the name of what? Zacchaeus, right? So Zacchaeus can't see Jesus because he's a little guy. I know there's a song. I remember, I can't even begin to sing it. You don't want to hear me sing anyway. But there's a little child, you know, song I remember from Sunday school about Zacchaeus. If these guys were here, maybe I would ask. Maybe Elwood knows. I don't know. I can't even remember it. But Zacchaeus, what did he do to see Jesus? He climbed a tree, a sycamore tree, which was very popular in that area. And Jesus sees him. He knows that he's a tax collector and a sinner, just like his disciple Matthew was. So Jesus calls him down, and he says that, I'm going to come to your home today. And he has this little house party with Zacchaeus and his tax collector and sinner friends. And, of course, Jesus was criticized for this. This man eats with tax collectors and sinners. That's why they wanted to crucify him. So he goes there. So we have that story. Now, the story I want to read you is the next pericope in Luke 19. And this is the parable of the 10 minas. And minas are sometimes it's translated as bags of gold. Sometimes it's translated as talents. But it's a parable that Jesus tells here. And when I read this, what I want you to hear is what kind of king this man is that Jesus talks about in this parable. So remember that Jesus is talking about a certain kind of king, And then he's going to go into Jerusalem, which is the next thing that happens, being proclaimed as a king. So that's where the Palm Sunday part comes in. I'm not going to read that today. You're familiar with it. He goes into Jerusalem right after he tells this parable. Where is Jesus telling the parable to 10 minas? In the home of Zacchaeus in Jericho. So he goes there. He stops on the way of Bethphage and Bethany, right on the outskirts of Jerusalem. That's where he picks up his colt or donkey that has never been ridden. Then he rides into Jerusalem with all the acclamation, the hosannas and everything. And then the very last thing that happens is that Jesus enters Jerusalem, and one of the first things that he does is he turns over the tables of the money changers and calls them a bunch of thieves. So those are the four separate stories. So what I'm saying to you, this, the Palm Sunday does not happen, or what we call Palm Sunday, does not happen in a vacuum. It comes right after the parable of the 10 minas that Jesus tells in the home of who? Zacchaeus. So let's listen to that. It says, while they were listening to this, and what they meant by this is Jesus just said to them, today salvation has come to this house because this man too, referring to Zacchaeus, is a son of Abraham, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Then Jesus begins. While they were listening to this, he went on to tell them a parable because he was near Jerusalem, and the people thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear at once. And he tells them this parable. Now, what I want you to listen to is get in your minds the kind of king here that Jesus is talking about. And what I mean by this, does this king sound like a kind, compassionate person, or is he mean, vengeful, and vindictive? So let's listen. A man of noble birth went to a distant country to have himself appointed king and then to return. So there right away, Jesus, it sounds like he could be talking about himself, right? Because he's someone coming from a distant place, heaven, and he's coming to make himself king. Remember, the next thing that's going to happen after this parable, he's going to come into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. So he starts off with that. So if I'm listening to this, I'm automatically thinking that Jesus is probably talking about himself. But there's different twists and turns in this. So let's listen to what Jesus says about this king. So this king, he called 10 of his servants and gave them 10 minas. He said, put this money to work, he said, until I come back. But his subjects hated him, and they sent a delegation after him to say, we don't want this man to be our king. He was made king, however, and returned home. Then he sent for the servants to whom he had given the money in order to find out what they had gained with it. The first one came and said, sir, your mina has earned 10 more. And a mina, 10 minas is about 3 months' wages. He said, well done, my good servant, his master replied, because you have been trustworthy in a very small matter, take charge of 10 cities. And the second came and said, sir, your mina has earned 5 more. And his master answered, you take charge of 5 cities. And then another servant came and said, sir, here is your mina. I kept it laid away in a piece of cloth. I was afraid of you because you are a hard man. You take out what you did not put in, and you reap what you did not sow. His master replied, I will judge you by your own words, you wicked servant. You knew, did you, that I am a hard man, taking out what I did not put in and reaping what I did not sow. Why then didn't you put my money on deposit so that when I came back, I would have collected it with interest? And then he said to those standing by, take the mina away from him and give it to the one who has 10 minas. And sir, they said, but he already has 10. And he replied, I tell you that to everyone who has more will be given, but as for the one who has nothing, even what they have will be taken away. But those enemies of mine who do not want me to be king over them, bring them here and kill them in front of me. So what kind of king does this guy sound like? Does he sound like a nice, compassionate guy, or does he sound sort of mean and vengeful? Mean and vengeful, right? He says, those who did not want me to be king, bring them here, and I'm going to kill them. So think about the people listening to this parable, many of them who thought that Jesus was talking about himself. But as Jesus begins his final move on Jerusalem, these words of the king in the parable were ringing in the ears of those who did not want Jesus to be the king. As for these enemies of mine who did not want me to be king over them, bring them here and slaughter them or kill them in my presence. So this is what is the last words that they hear from Jesus before he makes his move into the holy city of Jerusalem. So the people thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear at once, and they had every expectation that the coming kingdom of Christ would be like all kings of their day and like the king in the parable that Jesus just talked about, someone who was hard, someone who was ruthless, and someone who was vengeful. Imagine the tension. Put yourself back in that day. Imagine the tension of all involved in this high drama of Jesus' entry into the city. He's been making his move on Jerusalem for 3 years now. The Romans, the Jewish authorities, the disciples, and other followers of Jesus, and the crowds of people. As Jesus begins his movement toward the city, it's hard to predict what Jesus is going to do. It really is. Is he going to bring salvation, or is he going to bring slaughter? Is he going to bring reconciliation, or is he going to bring revenge? Is he going to bring peace, or is he going to bring the sword? So as Jesus approaches the city, some hope that he will drive out the Romans. The people hated the Romans. Their land was littered with Roman crosses of crucified Jews and others. And they wanted to recover the Jews from oppression, to drive out the Romans. And others want him to push out the corrupt King Herod. Remember what King Herod did to Jesus' cousin and forerunner, John the Baptist. What did he do with his head? He put it on a platter, right? So they want vengeance. Others want him to push out King Herod. And the people thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear at once. And Jesus was going to be God's own king, the Messiah. And some heads were going to roll. They wanted Jesus to be that harsh, hard king that Jesus told about in the parable. That kind of king was the only kind of king that they had ever known. Mean, vindictive, murderous rulers like Herod and Pontius Pilate. The people wanted Jesus to be like all the kings that they have always known. They have not known any other kind of king. Even when you go back into the Old Testament, all the accolades given to David. Remember what the saying there was, that Saul killed his thousands and David did what? David killed his tens of thousands. Right? That was the shouts that came to King David. Are we that different than the people of Jesus' time? They wanted Jesus to be the king, but to keep the old model of kingship in place. But they would have known that Jesus wasn't going to be a new king based on an old model, but he was going to be a new king based upon a new model. Everyone get that? Jesus was going to be a new king, but most of the people thought he was going to be like all the other kings who were mean, vindictive, and murderous. And that's what they were expecting. But Jesus wasn't going to do that because he was going to be not only a new king, but there was going to be a new model of kingship. Remember the two parables I talked about last week from Luke chapter 5. What were they? The new what? The wine and the wineskin, and the new garment. What did those parables teach us? That you can't put new
wine in an old wineskin. Why? It's going to break, right? Because when the fermenting process happens, the chemical reaction happens. If you put a new wineskin in with new unfermented wine, it's going to, you know, ferment and all that kind of chemical reaction, that's a bacterial breakdown, it's going to happen. It's going to weaken the wineskin, but by the time it gets to the end process, the old wineskin will hold the old wine, right? But if you have new wine and try to put in the old wineskin, it's going to burst. And in a very similar way, he talks about the garment. You can't put a new garment patch on an old garment, otherwise it's going to tear. So there again, you see that teaching, that you cannot put something new into something old. It's not going to work, right? So Jesus, on Palm Sunday, he wasn't going to be the old kind of king, the old model that everyone was used to. He was going to be entirely different. People never understood the parables that Jesus taught. He already told them this, but they're not listening, right? You see, as Jesus wasn't new wine poured into old wineskin, but everything about what happened on the first Palm Sunday never happened before, right? This event, a Palm Sunday, never happened before. Jesus had an entirely new agenda as he approached Jerusalem. Jesus told two of his disciples to go ahead. He says, you will find a colt there, a new colt, never ridden before. And he said to the disciples, if the owners ask you why you're taking it, just say that the Lord needs it. I always thought about that one. If I see something I want, I'll just take it and say, just say the Lord needs it, that's why I'm taking it. And I have credibility in that, right? I can say I'm a pastor, I can just take it because I need it for the Lord. I don't know how well that would work or not. So, but you think about that, what difference, I mean, from a strictly physical way, what's the difference if the donkey would have been ridden on before? It doesn't really matter. But it was making a point, right, that what Jesus was going to do when he entered Jerusalem on Holy Week was something that has never been seen before. It's an entirely new thing. And Jesus picks a colt to fulfill the words of the prophet Zechariah back in Zechariah chapter 9. Your king comes to you on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And Jesus enters the city, as Zechariah predicted he would, humble and riding on a donkey. So the message is clear. As the saying says, Jesus riding into the city on the back of a donkey is really a picture that says 1,000 words. It's saying that I come in peace. I am all about reconciliation, not revenge. So Jesus answered the question that people were asking, what kind of king was Jesus going to be? Was he going to bring peace or the sword? Was he going to bring vengeance or forgiveness? So the answer is clear. The reason they were shouting crucify him a few days later, that wasn't the kind of king they wanted, right? They wanted a new king, but they wanted the new king to act like all the other kings. It just depends on whose side of the bread is being buttered. And most importantly, the message of today is that Jesus' entrance into the city, it was not happenstance. It was not human, but of God. Zechariah prophesied these events 500 years before. And Jesus was doing something new. He was doing something that was never done before. And what he did was God's plan of unconditional love for you and me and all of us. Sure, Jesus could have charged into the city on a war horse. He could have had 10,000 armed angels on each of his sides. Jesus could have had Herod and Pilate, as well as every tyrant king of the day, had their heads roll in front of him, like the vengeful king in the parable. But Jesus kept to his Father's script. You know what's so amazing about Jesus? Remember that he was God, but he was also human. I'm sure everything that Jesus went through, the constant harassment, the constant threats that he dealt with, there's had to be a part of him that wanted vengeance, right? But he kept to his Father's script. He kept, thank God for us, that he did not deviate from the Father's plan. And that's a message for us too, right? No matter how hard it is, no matter what the world does, no matter how much opposition you have, whose plan should we stick to? God's, right? We should be like Jesus and following the Father's script. Remember that he even said, like, when he went to the cross, he said, not my will, but your will. If you could take this cup from me, Lord, Father God, please do so. If there's another way to do this beside me going to the cross, please do so. But Jesus was resolute, right? Absolutely resolute in keeping to his Father's script. If he did not keep to his Father's script, we would be eternally damned, every single one of us, right? That's what the gospel proclaims. Because if Jesus did not go to the cross as the Lamb of God and his blood shed to forgive us, we would all be, you know, in deep doo-doo. So the crowds of disciples, they gather around Jesus as he begins his descent down the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives is also the place where Jesus ascended back into heaven 40 days after Easter. It's you know how you have mountains and you have one mountaintop and the other. So the Jerusalem and the Mount of Olives were separated by the Garden of Gethsemane that was in the valley. They were about 3 miles apart. So you had like one mountaintop and the other mountaintop. One was Jerusalem, one was the Mount of Olives. And the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus was arrested and spent time in prayer, where he sweated drops of blood, was that valley in between. So the crowds of disciples gathered around Jesus as he begins his final descent down the Mount of Olives. He's very close to Jerusalem now. And they begin to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles that they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Now, if you read that in the shouts of acclamation from the crowds of disciples, listen carefully and you can almost hear an echo of the angels that welcomed the baby Jesus in Jerusalem. Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace among those whom he favors. If you read them back to back very quickly, they sound exactly the same what the people were shouting on Palm Sunday and what the angels were singing in Bethlehem on Christmas Eve. So some Pharisees were in the crowd when this was happening as Jesus begins to go towards Jerusalem. And they demanded that Jesus stop the crowds from shouting out praise and glory to Jesus as King of the world. And Jesus said, even if I could stop them, it really wouldn't matter because the stones would sing out. You know what that means? That God has a plan. It's going to happen. No matter how much we resist, no matter how much Satan activity there is, no matter what happens in this world, it's going to happen. Because if the people do not praise God, he says, even the stones will. So it's a way of saying that, hey, it's going to happen no matter what. You know, I heard it explained once like this. It's like a ship that leaves New York and heading to London, or vice versa, I guess. And there's a lot of activity on that ship. People are moving around, they're playing games, they're writing letters. And, you know, of course, this is a while back, you know, when they actually had ships that went from London to New York. But there's all this activity on the ship. But in a month or so, what was going to happen? That ship was going to get to its destination. Didn't matter what all the movement and activity happened going on, it was going to happen if it was God's will. And so God is saying that, look, you're either going to praise me or you're not, but my will is going to be fulfilled one way or the other. So what Jesus accomplished this week that we call Holy Week, by the way, I want to remind us, sometimes we call this Easter Week. This is not Easter Week. Easter Week begins with Easter Sunday. This is Holy Week. And what does holy mean? It means that it is a set apart week. It is all about you and I and God's love for you. So that's what this week is about. It's a reminder of God's love for us. Holy means to be simply to be set apart from everything else. So I do hope that this week, from now until Easter Sunday, that it's just not another week in your life. That it is, as Christians, if we don't show the world a difference, how are they ever going to see it? So this is a week that God has set apart for us. At the end of Luke chapter 19, the first place Jesus goes to in the temple, when he enters the city, where does he go? Yes, he goes to where the money changers are selling the animals for sacrifice. I don't know. I never lose my voice during the week, but every Sunday I'm starting to lose my voice now. Maybe it's the devil. I don't know. But he goes to the money changers, and he overturns their tables. What are they selling there? They're selling animals to be sacrificed for blood sacrifices. So because there would be no need for them, as Jesus was going to be the one-time Passover Lamb of God, and he was going to be the one-time high priest, not one time a year, like, you know, they still celebrate, the Jewish faith still celebrates the Day of Atonement. When I was in Israel, I was walking to the Wailing Wall, the Western Wall, and I had people come up to me and said, did I want to buy an animal, usually it was a chicken, to sacrifice, you know, the blood for my forgiveness? And I said, Jesus already took care of that a long time ago. I don't need to buy a chicken. But that was what the animals were sold to, because remember what happened the original Passover. The lamb's blood was shed to save people, the oldest son in Egypt, from death. So that was a major celebration every single year, the Passover. But Jesus becomes the Passover lamb that takes away our sin forever. We don't need to shed any more blood. Like, think about this. His blood that was shed covered every single sin that was ever committed, if we ask for that. Like, every sin you commit, anyone who ever existed, that one-time sacrifice covered every single one. And he was the high priest, too, the scripture says. So it was not just a one time a year. It was one time forever. I don't know about you, but that's a hard concept to get my mind around. That Jesus, when he went to the cross, when his blood was shed, every single sin ever committed was forgiven. Right? Now we have to claim the prize. That's part of it, right? It's a prize that he gives us for forgiveness of sins. We have to accept it. But that's what it deals with. So when he turned over the money changers' tables, what was Jesus saying there? He just wasn't being mean. He was saying, well, you know what? We don't need any more animal sacrifices because I am the one-time Lamb of God, so that you can have eternal life. I will deal with all sin in this one circumstance, this one time, and that will deal with all sin forever so that you can have eternal life. And that's the heart of the Christian faith, isn't it? That is, to me, the heart and core of the Christian faith. That's why in every church there's a cross somewhere, like a cross on the altar, a cross up there. Like, because that is front and center. Because it is front and center. His sacrifice on the cross is everything. So this is what Holy Week is all about. What Jesus accomplished in a one-time event, it will never happen again. It doesn't have to. We celebrate it and we remember it, but it was forever once in an eternity event. So we don't have to redo it again. It's good forever. And I want to wrap up with these words from 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. And this is one of those Bible verses. Sometimes you need to explain it, and sometimes it's so straightforward, there's nothing else to say. And this is one of those very straightforward Bible verses. It says, Christ, and these are not my words, so if you don't believe me, just believe God's word, right? Christ died for sins once, right? Once. For all, the righteous and for the unrighteous. When you say the righteous and the unrighteous, who does that cover? Everybody, right, says the righteous and the unrighteous. So whether you're a really good person or maybe you're not so much a good person, it doesn't matter that his death forgave all those sins. And then I'm going to continue on here to bring you to God, right? So his death is the cross that brings us to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. So folks, that's what this week is all about. For some of you, this is probably something that you know. Maybe you need reminded. We all need reminded because we go out into a world that has a very counter-Christian message all the time. It's all about greed, about money, about vengeance. That's the message we hear day in and day out. But we are a sanctuary, right? The church is to be a piece of heaven to show the world what heaven is like. Did you know that? That's what church is to be. We are to be in our best state. We're supposed to be a little island of heaven so that everyone else can see what heaven is all about. And that's what it is all about. So some of you know this, and some of you know, I don't know anything about this sin stuff and about Jesus dying for our sins. If you don't, please come talk to me or give me an email, phone call, whatever. There's other people in this church I know that you can talk to also. But this is the heart of who we are as Christians. This is like Christian 101, that Jesus went to the cross, died for our sins one time to forgive us. It's not even that complicated, right? It's pretty straightforward and simple. And we are to be a little part of heaven until, as we pray in the Lord's Prayer, until Jesus comes again. Amen.
Oh,
May God bless you and keep you this week. May you observe a holy, holy week and go in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.